I welcome you all the viewers to my show, jiska naam hai the Ridima Wali show, and all the viewers who are watching us on the Chai Time, a big hello to all of you.
Hi guys, all my Chai Time viewers, a big hello to you. This is Khyati at the Ridima Wali show, and Ridima is going to ask me a lot of questions. Want you to be all alive, kicking, and a big hello to all my clients in Dubai, Bahrain, London, India, everywhere.
All right. Like I always say, the Ridima Wali show has been crafted for each one of you. For you to post your questions, your confusions, your dilemmas of life, and get some triggers in perspective from the guests who we call on board. And, you know, I was just wondering, who should I be calling next on my show? And this trigger came my way that a lot of us crib out our long schedules, our daily, you know, travel, and how we miss our meals in between, which either leads to erratically working long hours at office or skipping meals, loss of appetite, or completely succumbing to cravings, which leads to weight loss or weight gain or obesity. So I have with me today a lifestyle expert who has been the youngest chief nutritionist in India. She was just 23 when she achieved this feat. And her personal battle with weight gain and PCOS led her to create India's first digital health tech startup called Balanced Nutrition. And what's truly intriguing about the startup, guys, is that it started way back in 2014 with 4 clientele. And today, that number has hit 10,000. So let's hear a lot more about the entire venture and the lifestyle disorder, how to tackle the lifestyle disorder weight gain in an efficient way despite the busy schedule, from a multifaceted guest, jinka naam hai Ms. Khyati Rupani. Khyati, welcome to the show.
Hi Ridima, how are you?
I'm good, how are you, Khyati?
Very well, thank you.
Khyati, you know, when I looked up and I did my research on you, I think I was completely inspired for the way you've started this venture, Balanced Nutrition.
Yes.
And we'll talk about Balanced Nutrition, but before that, I want to know what led you to choose this entire profession of becoming a nutritionist and a dietitian in the long run.
Okay, you want me to tell you the truth, Ridima?
Hmm.
Well, I was aspiring to be a doctor like any other medical student there. And I come from a family where my dad was very unhappy when I got admissions in Dhule, okay, which is 40 kilometers away from Nashik, and he said nothing doing. So I was all frustrated and I said, fine, let me leave that seat and let me go and just study something for 1 year and apply again for the exam.
Yeah.
So physiotherapy, nothing about the profession, but I was not happy making people exercise since I was the lazy bum. And
very candid.
Yes, and being a dentist again did not click, because at that time you look up to being a doctor and saving lives, and you know.
Hmm.
So the only thing came my way was nutrition, and I said, let me just, you know, get into this. I'll study. I'll just, you know, do the first year of BSc, apply again. But when I entered that field, I loved it so much that even after master's, I wanted to go on and on and on. Also, at that time in India, they had just started offering clinical nutrition, you know, and a master's at that. So that was something that really, really, I liked it. And I was always a little plump. I loved food, came from a basic Gujarati family. So come on, this was like healing people through food. So when next year Papa asked me, are you going to fill the form for CET again?
Yeah.
I said, not needed. And that's how it was an alternate career choice, which worked very well.
And Khyati, you serve more than 10,000 people all over the world today. So what is that joy that you get in serving your clients? What is that big kick you get from your profession?
You know what I would say is, there are many dietitians out in the country, in the world. But I'd rather say I've experienced what it is to be fat. I've experienced what it is to go to a store and hear that you're not going to get clothes of your size.
Yeah.
Even today, it is being fat is not just a lifestyle or a physical issue. It is a very mental issue. So even today, when I'm shopping, I will pick up the L first. I'll pick up the M first. And then the attendant will be like, ma'am, you fit in excess. So, you know, it is something that has a lot to do with the mind. It has something a lot to do with your self-esteem. And believe me, I know what it is to love food. I know what it is to eat.
Yeah.
And I know what it is to battle health issues. So what connected me in the first place was I knew what that person is going through, you know. Giving a diet chart is not going to be the only solution that's going to help him, because everybody knows tala hua nahi khana, everybody knows ye nahi khana, wo nahi khana. But how do some people succeed and some people don't, right? So this was my own journey that I went into, being, you know, a very, very overweight person at a point in life where I said hi to PCOS, I said hi to insulin resistance. I had to be operated for slip disc at the age of 2003 it was. So I was second year of college, degree college, so around 19, 20 years old. So this was what it ill health had done to me. And when I started following things and when I started getting my own answers as to tonight I have to go out, I have to go and eat a dinner. What do I tell everybody? Am I on a diet? So that's when sustainability came in. So this whole journey that I took myself, and I know how I feel today, you know, a thin Khyati thinks differently. The entire outlook changes. The little one at home is very, very happy. And now when I do it to somebody else, so the only thing that is the most, what do you say, sought after activity in our offices, when Saturday we collect all the feedback, and when, you know, our positive feedback comes to about 80, 85, and, you know, our negative feedback comes to about 1. And that negative feedback is something we really, really work on, because the positive feedbacks are so many. So I think that's the joy and that's the kick that, you know, somebody sitting in some corner of the world being online, where they don't even come to see us, or where they, the trust factor comes into the picture, right? You're sitting in one corner, swiping your card, enrolling for 3 months. So that is one big thank you to all of you who trust us. So of course, we all get sleepless nights at office. All of us are awake, making sure that yes, whatever we've promised is delivered, you know.
So probably it's your personal tryst with that pain, weight loss, that leads you to empathize with your customers and clients so much to that extent. And at this point, I would request all the viewers who are watching us live on the Ridima Wali show and Chai Time to post as many questions, because we have the expert maestro herself in here to address all your questions.
Time for questions.
Please make use of this platform, as we will be coming up with a question section in a few moments from now. Back to your personal journey, and you're also observing a lot of people battle weight loss. So what is the impact that lifestyle has to bear on the kind of diseases or all the disorders they come up with?
Right. So firstly, Ridima, let's talk about the difference between a disease and a disorder. Whenever a nutritionist comes into the picture, it is always about a disorder. Now, what is a disorder? A disorder is something that has no cure. Okay. So like PCOS is a disorder.
Can you highlight a bit about PCOS? I mean, there's a lot on the internet.
So I'll finish the disease disorder part, then move to PCOS. Great. So what happens is, when a disorder comes into your life, like a blood pressure or a diabetes or a thyroid or an abnormal hormonal profile, that is when it has no cure. So the doctor is going to give you a medicine, but don't be under the impression that the medicine is going to cure you. The medicine is only going to help you manage it. The whole idea of a nutritionist is to make sure that you are managing that disorder. Everything comes back to normal just by following a smart diet plan and a lifestyle plan. So today, geographically and lifestyle wise, we have, you know, crossed all borders. We are no longer Indian subcontinent eating only roti sabzi, right?
Sure.
So even when I have a restaurant guide that goes to a client in any part of the world, it is 46 cuisines. Because tonight the dinner is going to be a non-Indian dinner at most places when we go out. Or when you are out and you are at a meeting, I'm not going to be able to tell you, Ridima, okay, now stop your show, it's 4:20, it's time for green tea. Right? So these things do not, they are not practical, and that is what has happened. Our lifestyle is become that way. I have an air hostess, same PCOS, all right. She eats at 3 a.m. when she lands, she's hungry, what to do? Right? I have producers, I have people who work in shifts. So lifestyle has a major impact, but can we change that? Can I ask somebody to change their career? I can't, right?
Yeah.
So as a nutritionist, what we do is, many of us are following the very traditional route. Ye mat karo, 7 baje dinner khao. None of our diet charts have time. Because, come on, the person is coming home at 10. How can I ask the person to eat at 8? Right? So today, what I believe in is, whenever we plan a diet chart, we first send across an assessment sheet. Thanks to the techies we have there, immediately the country's temperature, weather, food preferences, geographical availability of food, etc. is all captured. So you suppose are in US or you're traveling to US, right from the airport guide to the in-flight guide to the foods available there, come on the screen of the mentor.
So that's the power of technology.
That's the power of technology, you know. So that is when the dietitians here pick up that, okay, this person is here, the temperature is here. Now imagine if it is 2 degrees and I'm sitting in Bombay where it is 40 degrees. I'm planning a cold juice for a client who's in Andheri, but I cannot do that to a client who's in a cold region, right? So that is the difference here. So that is why Indians across the globe are really, really liking this platform, because there is a connect of modern as well as traditional mix. And yes, lifestyle plays a very important role. Whatever we are today is because of our lifestyle and stress.
Coming back to stress and lifestyle, Khyati, usually people in my network, you know, if I tell that I'm planning to go to a dietitian, they say, "Tu bimar hai kya?" Yeah, that there'll be soup, salad, and it's just not palatable.
It's stereotype.
It's stereotype that way. Or they think ki yaar daliya khane ko milega, abhi aur kuch nahi milega. So in your view and your experience that you do with balanced nutrition, are you able to infuse taste and good health?
Wow, Ridima, so again, you know, this is a program or this is like a company that was started by a girl who enjoyed food, okay? Who loved food, who could eat each and every item present in a 50-dish buffet and not say no to a single thing.
Yeah.
So this has come from that girl. So if you open my website and if you go to the recipe section, we have now more than 700 recipes. Mm. The reason being, it's online, right? Mm. So the website travels. You don't know where it is going. Suddenly you have an enrollment of a couple of Bengalis from Calcutta. Suddenly you have an enrollment of a couple of Assamese. So when you open my website, not only will you see Korean, Mongolian, vegan, but you will also see Assamese. You will see Bengali. That is the power of, again, just mixing the right ingredients. It is never about soup and salad. Whenever I say soup and salad, in my mind, there comes this man who is running his company or who's a very busy executive. See, anybody who's overweight, anybody who is having hypertension, they are at a position where they need to work. They cannot be, you know, a person having 10 people around and just sitting and just, you know, enjoying life.
Mm.
So they need energy. Similarly, a housewife after delivery. So she's not going to be sitting and chilling, right? She's going to have a lot of work. She's going to look after the child. She's going to walk. She's going to do all the work at home. Maybe there are working women. So working means in India, dabba culture. So you cook in the morning, you put your dabba, you put the family's dabba, you come back in the evening, you're cooking again, you're making sure things are right. Same way, 15 minutes only, good. Same way, what I would also say is that even abroad, there are people who are dropping the child to the creche, cooking for the whole week. These people can never be on a soup salad.
Mm.
These people can never be on keto. Guys, don't try it. We are Indians, okay, by genes. We have to have our carbs. Only thing is how to have them smartly is something that we should look at. So yes, there is no soup salad. There is no dalia. Again, I know it is a little stereotyped. I know there are some dietitians who are yet doing it because geographically exposure is there only, say,
limited.
Mumbai practice, right? So yeah.
So, Khyati, we did have a couple of questions that I want to take on. Like, Sakina wanted to know, what's your thought on ketogenic diet? Is it a sustainable option? I know you partly answered it, that ketogenic is not practical for
yes.
the kind of ecosystem we exist in, but
right.
we want to address it for all the questions.
Yes. So, about keto diet, my viewers must have already heard it, but I will again, for Adima's viewers, this is the answer. A ketogenic diet was got into practice to treat epilepsy in children below 5 years old. So it is a clinical. It is a clinical diet, which when I was an intern at Hinduja Hospital, we were given a case just to study that. So a keto diet is 95% fat, where the child's diet used to be a slab of butter, 20-30 grams of paneer and 1 teaspoon of tomato, that less amount of carbs. So we used to make a paneer burji, which used to be drabbling in butter and give it to the child. Of course, since it's a child and since there are no lipid dangers, you know, we were administering it under care of doctors and every single meal was monitored, blood lipid profiles were taken, lot of things were done. Now in the name of keto in India, I see, you know, keto-friendly biscuit. Boss, ye hota nahi hai.
So there's nothing known as keto biscuit,
keto khakra, and nothing like that. A keto diet is 95% fat, where it is only fats coming from butter, fats coming from ghee, fats coming from cheese. I would even say cheese is about 70% fat, so that also has to be in very limited amounts. Similarly, when we are talking about keto diets, a diet which is not sustainable is keto, a diet which is not sustainable is low carbs. So guys, please don't do keto diets. Whenever somebody does a 2-month keto, loses 15 kgs and comes to us, I first tell them to go to the doctor, get a lipid profile done. The lipid profile is always altered. Cholesterol is always high.
All right. So that was on the keto front. And we also want to know that how whey protein and BCA, to all my friends who are building muscles, helps in building muscles, because they have this obsession with having yes. huge amount of proteins and pumping and flexing muscles. How healthy is that?
Okay. So again, whey protein and BCAA as a supplement, let me first define what is a supplement. A supplement is something that is extra, you know, yeah. supplementary income. Main job to karti hun, but I have extra. So a supplement is always extra. And when do you need extra? Why would you work extra? Mm-hmm. You need that extra income, right? That is why you're working extra. So it is the job of a nutritionist to decide whether you need that extra protein first. Mm-hmm. I have a lot of women who go to the gym who are 70, 75 kilos, who are doing cardio and they need to first become 60, 62 kgs. Mm-hmm. They are asking me for protein supplements thinking it will aid in weight loss. Now please understand, one scoop of that protein is about 20 grams. So what you have to understand is that a person who needs that protein is a person who's working out for a certain look and wants a certain amount of extra muscle, which the human body is not capable of producing on its own. So that extra is required, and that's why it is given. So the BCAA and the whey should be taken only and only after you ask your nutritionist, that also in amounts which are prescribed by nutritionist, not your trainer. Because most of the requirements are brought in through the diet. It is just extreme workout where a dietitian will not be able to put in 100 grams protein throughout the day, which again has its ill effects, which is kidney, etc. So see guys, nothing is very safe and nothing is very unsafe. What you need to do is you need to understand how often and how much. Ridima, since we were talking about making this 4:30, can we make this 4:45? Because my viewers are going to be
really... We can. It's all about you. That's
yes. So my viewers
so
would be
fact,
very...
In fact, there are some questions from the chat that I would like to take. So, you know, coincidentally, I was asking Manish, why there are so many questions on mango? And he said that we even uploaded a post on mango.
Yes.
So Mitali Daruka wanted to know, is it okay to eat sabji of raw banana, colocasia roots when on diet?
Yes. What we do is, in the diets, generally in an Indian diet, we have a lot of carbohydrates, right? So carbohydrates are coming from roti, rice. Carbohydrates are present certain amounts in the dal, in the vegetables. So just because the diet becomes too much of a carbohydrate, at times there are vegetables which are restricted, which ideally are not vegetables scientifically, they are starch. So a potato is a starch, a raw banana is a starch, a sweet potato is a starch. So anything that is roots and even corn, so they are not a vegetable, they come in the carbohydrate category. So if you are going ahead and having that aloo or having that raw banana or having the colocasia root, you will have to cut out on the portion of roti or rice that you're taking. Finally, you have to see your thali. Thali should have about 45-50% carbohydrates. The remaining should be protein, fat and veggies, right? So what we do is, in that case, write to your mentor. Mitali is my client. So write to your mentor. She will adjust your roti rice and she will make sure you get to eat that.
Alright, I always thought because I can have corn, I can have lots of them. So that,
no, see, corn is makai ki roti bhi banti hai, right? Hmm. So corn is a poor guy which is not vegetable, which is not even cereal.
Identity crisis ho raha hai.
Usko identity crisis ho raha hai, you know. So main, please understand, this whole corn, the glamorization of corn is coming from US. Hmm. Corn flakes, corn polenta. So there a lot of corn grew, but it was nutritionally a very, very poor choice because it doesn't even qualify to be a 100% cereal. Okay, but we are very good at marketing. No, we are Americans.
I know, and conflict has become the thing.
Yes, but that was very easy. So that's why clients here are told not to enjoy that expensive box of conflicts. Your upma pohas are excellent, and even in case you want to have a breakfast cereal, oats and muesli are a lot better.
All right, and another viewer from Chai Time, Aarti Agal, wants to know, are mangoes allowed in diet? And what is an ideal proportion? Because there are a lot of mango questions, guys. So, and even I love mango. So I want to really get clarity on what is the right proportion.
Yes. So the fat Khyati would eat mangoes in the form of, now India, okay, we love complicating our stuff. So the fat Khyati would eat mango on cream. Being a good Jew, there's amras. Which is daily in the diet. Then there's mango milkshake, mango pirni, mango kheer, mango barfi. Mango and cream shakes and freak shakes and these kind of mangoes are something you should stay away from. But mango as a fruit and an apple as a fruit is same. 90 calories, 90 calories.
Wow. So I can have one mango a day. It will keep
anytime.
Me
away. All clients
please,
here. Yes.
Please go and have mango. It's safe for health.
Yes. So as a fruit in between your meals, perfect. With the meal, you're adding carbs, right? So in between a meal, it will refresh you. It'll make sure you're not hungry anymore. And you'll enjoy it. It's your dessert.
Khyati, I have one more question on my show, and it says, are there any special diets for losing lower fat? And I really don't know what lower fat means.
Awesome. Lower body fat is what I'm, because see, women in India are generally the pear shaped, right?
Yeah.
So we generally talk about lower body fat. I am busting one more myth here, but the truth is that anybody, be it a trainer, be it the massage parlors, be it the vibrators, be it a doctor, be it a dietitian, anybody who is claiming to help you reduce fat from a particular area is joking.
Questions? Yeah, sorry. Is joking?
Yeah. They are joking because you do not have the power, or I can say nobody has the power to decide that you will eat this and fat from here will go. Or you do this or you do abs and the fat will go. No. Body fat is something that takes its own sweet time to decide. And yes, only and only a diet which is precisely made for fat loss helps in reducing fat from areas it is maximum. Now that maximum, just because you see it a lot here, doesn't mean that here it is maximum. Sometimes our love handles by percentage have a lot more fat.
Yeah.
Right? So the area here, you know, that also has a lot more fat. So you'll see that this is going, and then this goes sometimes, or sometimes this goes. So we really don't know. But yes, at the end of 6 months, you must aim for a toned body overall. So liposuction, yes, is one option where they give you and they make sure that that area is sleek and nice. But the moment you start eating again, you'll start putting on weight there all over again. So nothing's permanent. Nothing is, there is no, stuff like spot reduction.
So Khyati, what I'm picking up from this conversation is that an overall balanced diet will lead to overall body weight reduction. It will not be like from your thighs, you will suddenly lose all the
anything,
weight.
Not even an exercise, not even a pack, not even, a belt or nothing, nothing. There's nothing that can be done. There's no exercise that can help. There's nothing. They are all claiming it, but it is scientifically a gimmick.
Khyati, we'll take one more question from the Chai Time. And the question says, can we have fresh orange juice or watermelon juice?
Definitely. Now, this is in a context to weight loss, or she's just asking us?
She's just asking. Meenakshi Chaudhary is asking, probably in context of weight loss.
Okay. So, Meenakshi, hi. Whenever we are talking about a juice, a fruit juice is generally in India made after making sure that you are straining the entire juice. So what is left is hardly any fiber, which is very important. So the entire pulp, which is full of fiber, vitamins, minerals, is thrown out. And what you get is sugar, carbs and water. So these kind of juices, where it is fruit juice, we generally say the best option is to eat the fruit.
Yeah.
Why don't you eat the orange? Why don't you eat the watermelon? You'll feel amazing. In fact, right now in this season, imagine having a glass of watermelon juice. It'll just give you a sugar rush. In 20 minutes, you'll be the same old, tired and listless. Yeah. Rather, eat a bowl of watermelon, sprinkle some chia or sprinkle some pumpkin. You'll be nice and full and happy and good to go.
In fact, I have experienced this myself, you know, because I've been a lazy bum all my life. I think drinking juice is far more easier than eating.
Yes.
But actually, after juice, you suddenly, you know, the hunger pangs strike you and you feel like you can eat anything that will come your way.
That's absolutely right. But yes, given that, a vegetable juice is always a better option because vegetables by nature have a lot less sugar. Yeah. And we as human beings are not going to be able to eat as many vegetables as recommended. 5 to 6 servings of veggies are recommended. Now that is not possible.
Impractical
given our, impractical. So in that case, just go and smoothie it up and just gulp that. That's easier.
Khyati, we have some more questions lined up. But before that, there are a few questions that I had run a poll on Facebook and there were questions. So it's called the hacks round.
Okay.
All right. And the viewers wanted to know what could be the perfect hack for the following question they had. One thing was, what is the ideal breakfast that one should have?
Wow, an ideal breakfast for a South Indian can be anything from pongal to idli to a house which is busy, which can be muesli, sometimes a fruit, sometimes eggs. If he's a non-vegetarian, Ridima, what happens is being an Indian, okay, if I was an American dietitian, the entire country eats, you know, in one fashion.
Cornflakes.
You know, the American breakfast, the bacon, the sausage, the egg, the beans, the toast, you're done. Now let's go to Delhi. Aloo paratha is a breakfast in Delhi. I tell everybody make it dal paratha, so you include a protein. Paneer paratha is a delicacy. I tell them egg white paratha kar lo agar aap, you know, non-veg khate ho, tofu paratha kar lo. So here in India, telling you an ideal breakfast is like picking from 27 states and trying to understand what should be done. Having said that, a lot of us are always in a rush, right? So in this season, smoothies, go to the website, log in, see all the smoothie recipes. If you are on the go, grab a cereal, make sure the cereal is not sugar coated, make sure your children also do not have chocos and, you know, Cheerios and wheat flakes, because we did not grow up eating those.
That,
so we are not going to be able to sustain that, neither are we going to get the best health benefits. We are used to eating. So a khakra is a little better, I would say, than going ahead with all that. Right.
Which comes, which makes me come to the next part, which is a question on chai time. And they're asking wheat rotis fattening. What should we have in dinner time?
Okay. Flatulence, is it causing fatulence or is it fattening? I think it's fattening. Okay. Now this whole controversy about wheat also, no, Ridima, like all my clients, especially who are abroad, because they hear that everybody wants to go dairy free, everybody wants to go gluten free.
Why is the buzzword going around there?
Let's go back. See, all these concepts are very Western. India per se is not yet ready because of its diverse nature. We are not yet out there and saying this is healthy or this is blah. What happens is, in America, again, corn was the staple cereal. Same way in Europe, wheat was not the most preferred cereal. The breads used to be made out of rye, R-Y-E. So wheat per se was just easy to grow. The breads made out of wheat and maida stay and last longer.
Yeah.
The biscuits stay last longer. You can preserve it. The shelf life is high. So the entry of wheat in our lives became tremendous. But having said that, we as Indians were eating wheat for quite some time. So it's a Western concept, and yes, they have been eating starch potato hota hai waha. You know, you have veggies, you have the meat, and you have the starch. So the starch is a potato which now has been replaced at times with bread. So they are having insensitivity because they've not eaten it. It's like when we eat the pizza and the pasta. After three days, ghar ka khana chahiye, isn't it?
I agree.
So that is the whole gluten and dairy free issue where they did not have it before. I don't know. You know, why should we go on gluten and dairy free? Please go ahead and have your wheat rotis. Yes, but when you are on a weight loss diet, at times your dietitian might want to just change what you've been eating for years, because they say that if you keep eating what you have been, you'll keep weighing what you have been.
Yeah.
So temporarily, the dietitian just wants to shift things a little here and there, and when you are back to your normal lifestyle, you eat the wheat again.
All right. So Khyati, coming back to the hacks round. So next question was, and this was asked mostly by my corporate friends, that what is the best time to have dinner? As if they'll change the schedule, change the meeting and jump out of the meeting.
Yeah.
But what is the ideal time?
Yes. I would say before going to bed, okay, About an hour, hour and a half. So even if you're somebody who goes to bed at 12, reaches home at 10, try sitting for the meal by 10:30, 10:45. Can't help. I know. I mean, I know you all want to hear 8 baje khalo and then you all want to tell yourselves, ha dekh mera to lifestyle aisa hai, paisa kamao ya 8 baje khao. Forget it. I'm not going to follow anything.
I know. We just give in to our excuses.
You know, it's anytime, an excuse actually. But yes, and even the whole fact of, you know, breakfast like a king and lunch like, you know,
I hear a lot from my mother. Can you please break all the myth about
it? And then, you know, dinner you should eat like a pauper. But, you know, even given my lifestyle, the mornings are a mess in the house. Everybody wants to rush, right?
Yeah.
So Trisha is rushing to school, Vishal is running to office. I'm the one who's helter skelter just to reach, you know, and make sure things align up. So the breakfast is a very on the go thing, and being a Gujju, I was a mamra and a khakra person. I'm sure the Gujjus will understand. Or on a good day, mom used to make thepla in the morning. That is when she had time. So we have grown up eating this much for breakfast. Come what may, I've lost 45 kgs myself, Ridima, but I'm not able to change that about me. Even today, my breakfast is chai and khakra. That's genetic. You've grown up doing that. Now, suddenly, I can't start eating too much in the morning. And now, dinner is a time when I see my child, I see my husband, I want to talk a little. That is a time when achha bhala khana ghar pe banta hai. I am sitting and eating that. That is your body's mechanism. Similarly, I said air hostesses. And even people in the hotel industry, their shifts are erratic. Mm. So how, what should I tell them? Come on.
So, Khyati, which brings me to this question that, you know, like you said, there's a certain myth around that you should have breakfast like a king, lunch like something.
It's
like
ideal. Ridima, it's ideal.
Yeah.
It's like, you know, sending a client to, you know, a spa for a month where the client is not going to have anything else to do but just eat sattvic food, make sure everything is in place, no work, no cell phone. It is a lifestyle which I also would dream of, but I know given what we want to do,
it's
we won't
possible.
Sustain it. Yeah, we'd come back to, and again, when you're on a diet chart, the more difficult I make it for you, same way, you know, everybody comes and asks me about exercise. I'm sure somebody would have asked, how important is exercise? I have lost weight.
No, they have asked what kind of exercises they can do on the desk. This was the funny bit.
Very nice. No, for the desk, I think protect your spine, because I was somebody who could not protect my spine. I used to sit anyhow just to read and make sure I read. So yes, they are ergonomic exercises, but for weight loss, now there is a Khyati who was 90 kgs. What if Khyati was not a dietitian? She had to go to a dietitian. Now the dietitian is saying, listen, forget your studies, forget everything. Ab aap ye diet follow karo, ab aap roz 2 ghanta exercise karo. 1 week and the client runs away.
Yeah.
Everybody fails to do it. So then again, we come back to the whole practicality issue, right? So practicality, guys, whatever suits you. You cannot have exercise and diet together. It's all right. Just make sure you're eating smart. You please tell all these things to your dietitian. Whether you are in Iceland, whether you are in Israel, whether you are in the middle of the ocean, our job is to provide you with whatever is around you, educate you that eat this with this, eat this much, and then you will sustain yourself. So I tell my clients, even if you're going for an Italian meal, you should know how to plate your Italian meal. You cannot have the pasta and the risotto and the pizza. Go in for a soup, go in for a salad, go in for, if you're a non-vegetarian, go in for that piece of meat and then portion out your pasta, pizza, so that you're balancing out your veggies, you're balancing out your protein and your cereal. Everything, every cuisine is just about that, you know.
Balancing your plate.
Exactly. Nobody's asked ghee khana chahiye, you know.
No, that was in the myths round, so that's coming there.
Okay.
But people are asking on the chai time, which oil is best for cooking and can we eat pizza while dieting? And that's my predicament too.
Pizza while dieting, go ahead. Just make sure that according to your weight, according to your lifestyle, you know how much and you should know how often. That is something very personalized. Now coming to oil. It's like Ridima asking me, कौन सा सब्जी सबसे अच्छा है ख्याति पूरा साल टमाटर खा लूं
से मैं वेट लॉस कर सकता है मेरा
पूरा साल टमाटर खा लूं सो दैट इज द क्वेश्चन विद द ऑयल नाउ व्हाटएवर इज देयर इन सोया ऑयल इज नॉट देयर इन कोकोनट ऑयल व्हाटएवर इज देयर इन ग्राउंडनट ऑयल इज नॉट देयर इन फ्लैक्स सीड ऑयल सो इट्स लाइक मी पुटिंग यू ऑन अ डाइट और मी पुटिंग रिदिम ऑन अ डाइट वेयर शी इज ईटिंग ओनली दूधी फॉर द होल वन ईयर That is not possible. The nutrients from now, all oils contain different fatty acids. Some have monosaturated, some have polyunsaturated, some have saturated, some have MCTs. This is science. It's our job to know this. But yes, please try and buy an oil which is if you are a family of three, for me that 1 liter packet runs for a long time. So I next time buy something else. Then I buy something else. But now I have a question.
Keep on changing the oil.
You should. Okay. And again, it is again very random. Just make a note that last time I bought groundnut, this time let me try mustard, let me try soy. Now I have a question for Ridima. Ridima, all oils are so high in cholesterol, isn't it? Oh my God, you'll get a heart attack if you have these oils, right?
Yeah.
It's a myth. All okay. oils are zero cholesterol.
But they keep on saying, tala hua mat khao, samosa mat khao.
You want a bad dietitian, she doesn't know what she's talking.
But I really want to know because this is like a kaju? Lifelong.
Okay, then kaju ya badam, which has more cholesterol?
I think kaju.
None.
What are you saying? I'll worship you if this is true, man.
Yeah. Anything that comes from plants oh. is cholesterol free.
So like sunflower oil.
Cholesterol free.
Groundnut oil is not.
Cholesterol free. It's coming from plants.
Olive oil.
Coming from plants. Coconut coming from plant.
So then what causes people to have cholesterol? My question is that.
Yes. Let me finish this education. So nuts, all nuts come from plants. Everybody behind also is laughing.
It's like a revolution. Aapne unki zindagi ka dwar khol diya hai.
So first and foremost, the rules and regulations in India are pathetic when it comes to nutrition labeling and advertising,
yeah.
right? So that is why you tend to give in and you are fooled and you pay a bomb for an oil with orisinol, an oil which is cholesterol free, blah. No, it is. All oils are cholesterol free. Ganda wala postman oil le lo, rai ka tel le lo. Everything is cholesterol free. But does that mean it's healthy? No. Lipid profile karate na hum jab. Cholesterol aata hai. Phir na my clients are like, Khyati, ye LDL kya cheez hoti hai?
Yeah, you suddenly know? They become doctors and they ask you,
what is LDL, HDL, VLDL? So a lipid profile has all these, right? So your oil consumption is telling us the VLDL, LDL. It's telling us the ratio for you to upstroke. Yeah, you don't just get a heart attack, right? You don't just have high cholesterol. You have a lot of complications of cardiac diseases. So the stroke, so a vegetarian will have normal cholesterol, okay? But a non-vegetarian will have high cholesterol because animal se hi cholesterol aata hai. Okay. So milk mein cholesterol hoga?
Nahin.
100%.
Nahin, animal se aaya. Animal se, acha, that way.
Oh. Dahi mein cholesterol hoga?
I love
100%.
Curd.
Yes, because curd is coming from. Oh. So chicken mein hoga?
Of course.
Mutton mein hoga?
Hoga.
Correct.
Now I really think like it's like a class teacher asking to. Thank you, Khyati, for being educational. Khyati, we are inching towards the last segment.
Yes.
There is one question on the Ridimavadi show which says, which is better, the brown rice or the basmati rice?
Before answering that, I want Naveen Manish, in the comment section, I want to hear how was this Ridima show. So then I will tell the team back in office not to have chai time at office, but to ensure that you are getting more questions like these. If this was fun, guys, please write. Alpesh, you introduced, and Sakina, you both introduced us to Ridima. So Alpesh and Sakina, a big thank you. You all are stars on your own with such great weight loss. Please continue watching Balanced Nutrition videos and please give me your feedback. If no feedback, we are like saying bye to you in a minute. Yes, Ridima.
Yeah. So the question is, which is better, brown rice or basmati rice?
Yay. Again, a question which everybody is going to be like, what the? Okay. So brown rice per se is a cereal. Brown rice, 30 grams, 100 calories. Basmati rice, 30 grams, 100 calories. White rice, kolam rice, whatever rice. 30 grams, 100 calories. Now, then why do we say rice se wazan padta hai? Right?
Is it because of the quantity?
No.
Then?
I don't know. Myth.
Come on. Really?
Yeah.
For the last 3 years, I've been eating proportionate rice so that I don't gain weight, but I eventually gain weight. So
that's not the rice, isn't
what
it?
What are the three, like, you know, one of the questions which was very sporadically asked is, why do people gain weight? What are the three most common reasons? Before we take
one off. Is eating more than you are able to burn. Now these are not even thought, you know, Ridima. So suppose if tomorrow you are having a meeting or there is some script which went on for hours and hours and hours, and then you are served tea, coffee and biscuits. So now while talking, you are somebody who munched on that biscuit, okay, 1, 2, 3. Mm. I have clients who tell me, ah, main shaam ko kuch nahi, 4 biscuit aur chai. I'm like, really? Multiply by 30, you did it for a month, no? 120 biscuits.
Yeah.
Nobody realizes that. And then you all blame the roti, you all blame the rice. Phir raat ko, movies. You know, it used to happen with
me. I just
want
Infinity War with lots of popcorn, lots
exactly.
of chat.
Exactly. Yeah. But then that, kisi ki dimaag mein nahi aata. You know, and then when you're walking or when you're with your friends and when you're at a coffee shop, you've ordered your thing, but then friend ke paas ye hai, uske paas wo hai. You're not even realizing that. So most of our weight gain happens from A, foods we eat absent-mindedly. B, we don't understand the implication of a calorie dense food. Ab, you know, somebody says almonds are very good for health. If you eat 8 almonds in a day, theek hai na, multiply by 30.
Yeah, that's like lot of calories. 2400 calories.
2400 pieces you ate.
Yeah, and how many calories will that attribute to?
8 grams has about 90 calories.
Okay, badam literally needs to go out the window.
Again, it is about how much. So
it's
in
basically
the,
proportionate
yes,
eating.
Yes, yes. All it right. is about understanding the hidden sources. It is not about your roti, sabji. Don't blame them. But yes, in the night, har ghar mein aaj pizza banega. So nobody realizes that. And then, you know, there is this big question of why the ghee is good. Like first is ghee is good. Ghee khana chahiye. Roti mein ghee dalo. Rice mein ghee dalo. I'm like, yeah, cool, it's fine.
Khyati, your expressions dekhe lagta na, some questions itni peede tha that you really want to spread away.
Because, you know, I mean, understand that. You are not your grandmother. Dadi jo thi na, to wo kabhi bread nahi khati thi. Dadi jab, you know, the chakri and the chikkis used to happen. Chikki used to happen in Jan, then there was no chikki happening, right?
Yeah.
Chikki thodi na, abhi chikki milti hai mein mahine mein.
Yeah.
When it's a winter food. Yeah. So you are living in a zone which where there is globalization, where everything is available all year round.
Everywhere. Yeah.
Right? In this season, in 40 degrees, avocado spread you all want.
Yeah. I ordered it online.
Wow. There. Fat? For what fat?
It's
you're melting.
Like you're reading my mind, man.
You're melting, yeah. And then y'all are like, oh, you wasn't kyun nahi utar raha? You know why? Excuse me, there is season, there is climate, there is things you've grown up eating. So now you guys from being, you know, wo jo dadiyan thi, wo kabhi kuch nahi khati thi. Ab hamare dinners kya hota hai? I'm a vegetarian, so if I in a week, if Trisha doesn't see a pizza or a pav bhaji, of course it is, you know, give and take. There's trading happening.
That's ye banao, speaking.
Haan, ye banao, tum ye khaoge kal, ye karo, to ye karo. So, they are exposed to nachos, which is Mexican. They are exposed to sizzlers with so much cheese and chicken. And they are exposed to cheese. So, I'm telling, my debate with them is, okay, I'll add ghee in your diet, in the lunch and etc. Raat ko bhi Indian khana khana, desi, traditional. There I can then adjust it, because if you are wanting the modern lifestyle where you're not understanding the amount of invisible fat you are eating, that cheese has cholesterol, ghee is also cholesterol, you are replacing the ghee with cheese.
Yeah.
So then you can't say I'll eat ghee wala roti.
I'm not losing weight then.
Yeah, you want the ghee wala roti because ghee is very good for you. And you eat the ghee, you eat the rice, you eat whatever you want, you eat till you're full. Again, this eat till you're full notion, I was fat. I could eat 6-7 rotis at a go.
Really?
Because stomach is elastic.
Yeah.
Excuse me, I've got a habit, right? So, wo expand hota hai stomach. It can ingest. So, you can't eat till you're full.
Because
the mechanism of eat till you're full is not functioning well scientifically in a fat person. A fat person doesn't realize that I am full. It takes 20 minutes for the brain to register I'm full, right? It is a thin person. It is habit. It is understanding. So as a dietitian, I first tell my clients, realize when you're hungry. I cannot give you a diet which is 9 a.m., 12 and 3 and 6 and 8. It has to be that you are hungry and you automatically go and grab the next meal.
Rather than saying, oh, I had a long day, let me grab some beer or let me grab some chutna.
You should, the diet should make sure that you get up whatever it is and go and eat.
That eventually becomes comfort eating otherwise.
Yes.
So Khyati, two things I'm picking up from the conversation is eating in moderation and balancing out.
Eating everything. Balanced nutrition has an alcohol guide.
Yeah? Oh my God, I got
we have an alcohol guide. I have clients who are like, we socialize, what do you want me to do? I'm like, okay, go ahead. I like an occasional glass of wine. I like my daiquiri. But of course, the daiquiris that I used to have when I was fat, and now it's smarter. It's all about how much, you know, and making it very sustainable, actually.
Khyati, in the last segment, I just have one question to ask you. And guys, do check up Khyati's profile, her company, Balanced Nutrition. And what's really inspiring about this personality here is that she founded this company after she became a mother.
Yes.
And Khyati, many of us, you know, grapple with this dilemma.
Yes.
Now that I have a kid, my career is vanished. I can't move on. This is what I'm going to do. I'm stuck.
Yeah, yeah.
So my last question is really for all those budding entrepreneurs, all those girls who grapple with this question that having a baby or getting married means end of career.
Right.
That is how I want to
Right,
do.
Right. So what I would like to say is that before Trisha, I was full-fledgedly working in a career where the hospital that I worked in, who's who of any industry would be there. So 16-hour day was like, oh, today I'm leaving early. And that was what led to all the stress. I said I had PCOS, and then I had to go through a lot myself to have a normal Trisha. And when you hold that precious child, all you want to do is you want to just say, I'm not working. But given that fact, when Trisha was about 3 months old, I would really like to name him. He's Mr. Nirmal Jain from India Infoline, a very, very, very big personality in the finance world. He had, you know, seen me work before, and he happened to just ping me and he happened to tell me, what are you doing? I'm like sitting at home, and I did not take it up. And my mother said, knowing you,
you won't be able to do
yeah. this. So you're breaking your career, and then you will become miserable, and you know you're going to not be a good mother.
That's a vicious cycle.
You know, and that's a vicious cycle. So I said, fine. I went and I met him, and he also by then had moved to a very good office with a staff of 900, and that's when the whole thing started. He said, start planning meals for my guys because they are in the stocks. You know, so very stressful job.
Yeah.
So I started planning meals in the cafeteria. We made an executive cafeteria, and then the guys, they were too busy. So then it all started as, yeah, diet email kar do. Just email me the diet. Yeah, I'm very busy. I'm not coming. And I said, okay, I need to know some things about you. And they would be like, yeah, just send me your questions. So I made an assessment sheet. It was a Word file. You know, Naveen and all my team there that time used to laugh that, are you serious, ma'am? Used to give an assessment. So it all happened that way. I made an assessment, and then it was difficult to reach 900 people. Facebook had just started the whole page, page banalo types. And I just made one. I used to, the page traveled, and I had again the first client of Balanced Nutrition from Singapore who said, hi, you keep, you know, posting a lot of this gyan. See, again, you told me, look at your expressions. You want to give so much of, you want to break so many myths. So I was breaking a lot of myths in these mother groups on Facebook, and they used to be like, oh my God. And then The client from Singapore said, why don't you send me a diet chart? So I sent her one, and then she said, wow, I lost 2 kgs. Can you, you know, can you charge me? And I went running to Vishal, and like, Singapore se paisa, what is she saying? Vishal is like, yeah, charge her, you know, she's feeling bad. And Sri Devi was somebody who was at a very senior position in Bank of Singapore, which had 30% Indians. Started there, and now we are in 65 cities. How many countries, Naveen? Maybe more than that, 90 countries, maybe, yeah. So, and Indians are everywhere. You name it and they are there. Georgia, Jordan, and sometimes, you know, ma'am, ye kahan hai country? And even the cities, we say, oh, Ichal Karanji, or, you know, oh my God, you know, a small city in some part of India, and nothing.
I think your honest attempt to really add value to people's life is what counted and mattered the most.
So what started with 3 people in 2015 is today a group of more than 60 people holding hands.
That deserves a high five. Khyati, I'm so happy for you, and you're truly
Thank
an inspiration
you.
To not all the prospective clients and all your current clients,
yes.
but all those people who want to take the bet of entrepreneurship.
Yes.
And this is your host Ridima Wali signing off. But before that, a special mention of 2 of my college friends who actually recommended Khyati's name, and they were completely floored by the kind of services and suggestions and expertise they got from her team. So thank you, Sagina and Alpesh. And viewers, keep pouring in your questions. We'll try to address them once the show gets over. Thank you so much, the Chai Time viewers and Ridima Wali show viewers, for watching us.
Bye guys, see you.
Bye.